and the thinking will be done by cowards. I rest my case.
Thank you. I hope we are neither fools nor cowards in this room.
Absolutely.
I'm going to invite Comrade Kagoro to just speak on who is telling us and who is sponsoring our duties, our knowledge on the rights and our duties, and then to conclude as well. I will be very strict in terms of time.
Okay. The question of human rights sponsorship and whether or not it's collective rights and responsibilities or individual rights and individuation is a bit of a chicken and egg situation. Professor Issa Shivji has done a wonderful book. It's titled Human Rights in Africa, Volume 2. You can get it online. In essence, I think the question really is what rights are not sponsored? Because the rights that are not sponsored are rights around the big socio-economic questions, except now this question of climate change, because there is money for the externals in carbon trading and in just transition. So there's a lot of money now going into climate change-related rights advocacy. But anyone who's doing the rights contesting the mass grabbing of land and other deep socioeconomic matters, there's not that much money. Individual rights, Issa Shivji argues, carry a historical cultural baggage, which is a Western cultural baggage. But I don't want to get into an ideological simplisticness that dismisses all rights as non-universal, non-indivisible, because that's actually what autocrats have used. Right? When you have an objection to weaponization of human rights by the Western world, the extreme has been a total negation of human rights by some leaders and some demagogues and etc. Now, this is not a position, and I'm glad that I'm sitting in a country where there's a realization of the balance, right? But in most countries, so we all, as we speak about this, have to be careful that the weaponization must be contested. Because you cannot use culturally laden interpretation of rights in order to punish some, reward some, and ignore others. And at the same time, we should be allowed to privilege our own collective rights and obligations that you carry. Being African means if you take Ubuntu or Utu, whatever it is, it says, I am because you are. We owe obligations of mutuality and reciprocity to each other. Now, let me go to just one small clarification, madam, on FDI. General, my point, which I was trying to make, is this. There is no way we are going to industrialize without making investment in local economies, in rural economies, number one. But if you bring foreign investors, you need strong local content laws that enable locals to supply the value chain. Otherwise, what will happen? A big investor comes from outside. They import toilet paper, screws, and everything from outside. So that doesn't nourish the local economy. It also doesn't create the industrial base. What happens is you have short-term prosperity. So in essence, it is not an anti-FDI. But just to also caution, when we use Germany, Germany got over 375 million of the Marshall Fund. Marshall Fund was not FDI. Marshall Fund was a concessionary loan to develop. Then the last point is on when we're developing these economies, we need to think about creating sustainable economies means backward, forward, downward linkages. Now, those backward, forward, downward linkages relate to education as well. And so it's important that when we're looking at the forward linkages, at the backward linkages, and the downward linkages, we don't think only of top-level tertiary education. We think of vocational education, but other forms of education that may not necessarily be numeracy and literacy, but that enable people to participate and enter the economy. My concluding remark is this. Governance is not a luxury for this continent. What needs to be bridged in this continent is the gap that exists between its most educated people, its academic institutions, its private sector, its governments, and the generality of the citizenry. The history of suspicion amongst these different entities is what generates political instability and allows others to divide and conquer. To manufacture this, every citizen must feel they are treated with respect, with dignity, that they can access opportunities in their country and beyond. I am not persuaded, Madam Chair, that any single country, including Rwanda, can create enough opportunities for its young people solely within its own borders. This is why, if we had told all Europeans and all Chinese to go back to China and to Europe and to create opportunities for their young people and business only in China, they would have collapsed. The longer we take to integrate, the poorer we become. And there will be no exceptionalism. Tajuddin Abdurrahim said, it won't matter that one of our countries is heaven, and the others are in hell, because ultimately the hell will influence. So there will be no Rwandan exceptionalism, South African exceptionalism, and the South Africans know this. You don't fix governance in your neighbor's governance challenge ends up being your problem. And that's why I think what this conference is about domestic, regional, and global governance reforms necessary to sustain peace, but also to sustain sustainable wealth creation and eradication of poverty. Thank you.
Thank you. The longer we stay and united, the poorer we become.
Thank you for watching, and kindly consider hitting the subscribe button for more updates on important and powerful voices shaping the future Africa.